behind Zoom.
Zoomorama, baby.
High tech. Nothing but high tech here, everybody.
Yep. We've increased the budget. We can do 2 Zooms an episode now. Brent and I used to have to share a mug. That's why we could only do one.
Only one at a time. Yeah, let me hand you mine real quick.
That's right. You guys can't see it. We're actually just, hey, thanks, Brent. I'll pass it back to you now. We're actually right beside each other.
Perfect. Hey, how's the day?
Michael's complaining about the music. I tried to get my colleagues onto this, but they got scared when you play this music. Can't help some people's taste, you know.
You just can't.
Nope. Like our taste. I mean, we can't help that. We have bad taste. I'm just saying. Welcome, everybody. Hey, it's Wednesday here. Hopefully it's Wednesday or another day in your place, wherever everybody else is. And we're always happy to have folks join us. And Dan's saying lack of taste. That's us. Lack of taste for sure. Very cool. Folks, we've got Connie Malamed with us here this morning. Connie's been with us before, but if you weren't able to catch that, Connie, let's give you a chance to introduce yourself. Tell us a little bit about your background, those sorts of things before we get started here.
Okay. Well, my background's very boring. Oh. I fell in love with instructional design about 20 years ago, got a degree, and I've been doing it ever since. Oh. I have an e-learning coach, podcast and website, and a private membership community where I teach people instructional design and visual design and other stuff called masteringid.com, Mastering Instructional Design. And I'm really into visual design and creative kind of ways to make our jobs more creative, because we have to be creative on demand. So that's how I kind of started looking around, I don't know, maybe 5 years ago, at other techniques. We're so interdisciplinary. I love using the tools and techniques and methods from other fields.
Mm-hmm, for sure. Yeah, we are all often very much jacks of many trades and Jills of many trades. And hopefully, and maybe not masters, but at least successful in most of them, you know, as we go along too, which is actually, it is part of the fun of what we do, right? This new thing, here's a new challenge. I gotta learn this and add this to my my toolkit too. So yeah, very cool. Yeah. Hey, what was it that made you fall in love with instructional design? I like the way you phrased that.
I think it's that it involves that analytical part of your brain where you're really thinking and analyzing how things can work and understanding the audience and the content and what the audience needs to do. And then that other part of your brain, if they are different, I have no idea if they really are different, but I think of them as two different things. Just that creative aspect where you can harness your creativity. And then in the end, you're helping people. So what a great combo. You can get up every day and know and hope that you're helping people. Please.
That's the goal, right? That's what we do.
And it's such a helping field. You know, back then when I first got into it, nobody, you know, of course there wasn't social media, but it's such a helping community. I really love all the people. That's the other thing. Just love them. So
I think it comes from the fact that a good majority of folks in our industry come from being teachers, right? And teachers are always helpful and looking to help other people do things, and everybody's just so nice. It's been a long time since I've had a not nice teacher.
Or a not nice instructional designer. Yeah.
Yeah. Never heard of it.
No kidding.
Yeah, for sure.
No, it's very much true. It's that combination. I agree with all of those points. The thinking, that process, the creative aspects, the fact that you feel the thing you're making is fingers crossed contributing or improving something or helping. Yep. I bet you that's echoed by most folks that Jennifer says some of us non-teachers are kind of nice too. So something that's been with us. Okay. So here we go. Let's get controversial. Something that has been with us throughout our careers in instructional design is the ADDIE model. Aha. Mm. Uh-huh. And we included the ADDIE model because Brent wrote a clever title for this week's session.
It was clever.
Yeah. He's looking to stoke up some controversy here, as we were saying before. Going live.
They were fighting words, apparently. Yeah. I've triggered some folks, and so I hope everybody's okay with that.
Replacing ADDIE, why would we ever even want to do that? But more particularly with design thinking. Mm-hmm. And I think that probably most of us in our field are familiar with ADDIE, but let's get you to explain to us what design thinking is. I know we've done it on, I had conversations with folks at different, on different other episodes too. But maybe just throw out what's design thinking and then we can go from there.
Okay. So design thinking has multiple dimensions. It's a mindset. So it's not just one thing. It's very flexible, but it is a mindset of being open, questioning your assumptions, really using empathy to inspire human-centered design concepts. So that's one thing. It's a mindset. It is a process, and that's the part that's really flexible. And it is a tool set. So there are many tools borrowed from user experience design. I use tools from instructional design. You can basically think of it as a framework. This is how I think of it. There's a framework. Then you can fit in different tools during every phase of the process. And I teach workshops in this, and that's what we do. We might use a root cause analysis to define a problem. We might use an empathy map to get to know the audience members. So all these fantastic tools that are out there in all the different fields, including instructional design, like action mapping, you can just kind of fit into every phase. It's so flexible. And that could be a criticism of it. Like, hey, it's too flexible. I don't know what to do. Mm. So,
and could it be a supplement to ADDIE? Can it be, or can it help in certain ways? Like, I mean, maybe I'm rushing too far down the road here, but you know, how do we blend the two, or can we even?
I think we can blend the two. I tend to not use a waterfall method like ADDIE, but that doesn't mean that other people can't. There's probably some projects where you can use ADDIE where you really know what's going to happen. The information and the design is not volatile. And so you can go all the way through the process at the end and then, you know, at the end, evaluate it. But generally today, I would say, I'm guessing that most experienced instructional designers are adding some things to ADDIE that might make it more like the successive approximation model, where they're adding in prototyping, doing things in small, maybe not sprints, but in small segments, and continually getting feedback from users and stakeholders so that you can modify it as you go along. Because we're living in such a fast-paced world where knowledge is changing, skills need to be updated all the time, that a lot of times we need something a little bit more flexible. And it might just be adding prototyping to ADDIE. Then you've got like basically a new model.
Mm-hmm. Right? Certainly in other areas outside of instructional design, mostly have moved to more of an iterative process rather than the classic waterfall / blueprint model. Even in software development, you know, smaller things, achieve them, and then what's the next thing to achieve, as opposed to mapping absolutely everything out and then building it. And then also even web design world has moved to more of an iterative, kind of approach for sure. So we certainly, you know, can take benefits out of, or, and see benefits from taking those into the instructional design world. Alexander is pointing out that ADDIE has not been waterfall since 1990. And I think maybe that's just, as Jeff's saying, it's probably how most orgs just use it. There is that classic sense of, we've created this storyboard, we get sign off, and now we're gonna pass it off to be developed. And this is going to be matched, you know, exactly. But really, you could use ADDIE in shorter circuits. I mean, you've got that evaluation, the E at the end of ADDIE is evaluation, which isn't about assessment of, you know, test questions. It's really about evaluating the success of what you've created and then going back to the A with the analysis and cycling, you know, through that again and again. So,
you know, I think it's really good to remember that there are not instructional design police. And I would love to be one, though. No. That everybody can use, as long as we come up with effective solutions, it doesn't matter what model we use, what approach we use. And I would be surprised if people didn't modify their approach for the different situations. Yeah. I think that most people probably do that.
Yeah, and I think it's hard. I think traditionally, before lots of technology, it had to be linear because there had to be that sort of sense of quality. Yeah, someone dropped in the, you know, quality assurance type stuff. And so you went very linearly from one thing to the next, because it kind of followed that manufacturing approach. I think to Alexander's point, ADDIE probably still exists. The loop is just shorter, right? Instead of going from analysis all the way through DDIE and then done, now it's more like ADDIE, and you're looping it and you're just doing little mini moves all the way along. I guess that's the successive approximation or approach kind of redefined. But if you kind of think about it like that, they do kind of work together.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting what Jill is saying. Isn't the job of QA the ID police? But what I was talking about, Jill, was really there's no one to say what method you have to use. I mean, some of it is just how you're thinking about it. Yeah. You know, part of your method is how you view it. But anyway, back to the design thinking and whatever instructional design practice you use or model you follow, a typical design thinking approach, which comes from product design, and people have changed it all over the place, but it can be empathize with your users, define the problem statement, ideate, generating ideas, prototype, and test. So you can, the way I teach it in workshops is during the define phase, when you are defining your problem, that's when we put in our main instructional design work.
Yeah.
I have one slide I'll show, and then I'm not doing a presentation here, but what did you say? Oh, I can roll over myself. And just because, you know, sometimes making things concrete.
Yep.
Screen. Visual is good. We like that. It's good.
Share your entire screen. I think this will work. Oh, application window. Let me just share this. I just opened this up from a workshop. Okay. Am I sharing anything?
Yep, we see that.
It's shared.
Okay, so here is one way to approach it. Empathize with your audience during define. That could be iterative. You could go back to it, but this is when we tend to put, this is when I will have people do their instructional design practice. And often action mapping works here, but you could go back to a Dick and Carry method or whatever method you prefer. Then you ideate and go through that cycle of prototyping, testing, and ideation again.
I was answering Arpit in the chat. He was asking, hasn't Daddy always been that way? And it really hasn't, at least not the way I was taught it. In the original, back when I was first doing graduate school work in, you know, instructional design, curriculum design, whatever they called it back then, it was absolutely linear. They taught it very linear. The expectation was when you got to the implementation in the I, you were literally implementing the solution, the final solution, and all the work prior was supposed to be so perfect that you had a perfect solution coming out the end. Like it was, that's how exceptionally structured the whole thing was. And then you would evaluate it and see if you were successful in, and what it was. Most people didn't push it all the way to evaluation, but then you know, when you're out in the corporate world, you get that final product or project done, pushed out and sent out or produced, and now it's running. It probably doesn't get updated for another 18 months. And then, and then when someone says, yeah, well, you know what, we really need to update that course, you start over again, you do the A, and then you'd go through the whole process, but you just do it one time.
Yeah, it's almost like ADDIE in practice, the way that most places or most implementations or uses of it, that the E is an end point, as opposed to forgetting that, you know, there's actually an arrow back, should be an arrow back to the A again.
I think Chris has a really interesting point, and it's a good one. How do you balance that iterative approach with budget? Now, in my experience, it does not take longer or cost more to use an iterative approach, because you're getting feedback. You don't have to do it forever and ever. Especially when you're experienced, you have a sense of things, and you've already taken time to get to know the audience and the performance challenges that they have.
Yeah.
So sometimes getting buy-in from the audience or co-designing, which I don't usually get a chance to do, but I know some people do. I haven't seen it take longer. What I see is that we're more on track, and we come up with more effective solutions that are based in cognitive psychology research, if your client lets you. So I'm not talking about developing an entire module, let's say, in e-learning, but it might be that, you know, some little quick thing on an app or a job aid is the solution that you need. I'm sure everyone here has had someone come up to them and say, here, we need this course. And it turns out you don't need a course. It turns out you need to send people a PDF document.
I think one of the things that gets skipped in these conversations sometimes is that it's important to remember that not all of the work that we do follows the ADDIE model, and some of the work and some of the projects that we do, you can be iterative and you can be flexible. And to your point, you mentioned the client, right? The client always has a say in it too. And there were some questions being asked, like Jill asked, how far do you develop your prototype? You know, sometimes schedules, budgets, clients, personalities dictate when done is done. You might think it's done, but you get feedback from the client and they're like, no, do this instead. And you're like, but why? It's done. I've gone through the design thinking process with everybody. Even you guys approved it, right? And then they change their mind. So there's a lot of stuff.
You know, one thing I think that design thinking encourages is a holistic approach to a long learning journey. So rather than thinking in terms of a one-off course, which research shows usually one learning intervention is not going to help people really develop long-term capabilities. So a one-off course is for, you know, bam, here's something quick you need to know. Take it from here. But if we could, you know, you're on your own. But if we can begin to think in terms of learning journeys, that's where design thinking makes a lot of sense, because, you know, you will use spaced learning. You may use just in time, right in the workflow. You may use techniques that allow for building up long-term capabilities. You might add in social interaction so that people have a forum or a way to get together and discuss the problems. Because once you've applied something, new problems arise because you understand it better. So there are so many pluses to not thinking in terms of one course or one intervention and thinking about a long-term learning journey if we're trying to build real capabilities. Now, sometimes we're not. Sometimes people just need to, you know, a quick online reference tool, and that's fine.
Mm-hmm. And I think I don't know, instructional design culturally or whatever, like you said, people come up to you and, you know, say, hey, we need a course on this, but we do tend to think of creating a product, and typically a singular kind of a product, as opposed to something that a broader range of experiences to support things like taking people from information to actually applying that in the workplace, resources to help them 3 months later after they've forgotten what they took in the LMS, all of that, you know, to actually create improvement and create results. Then we often think about making a product called a course.
Right. And Alexander, apparently, I'm not sure why, but this seems to be triggering something for Alexander, but it says, wasn't the original ISD journey based on the system based on the whole journey? Now, in my experience, and I went to grad school, you know, over 20 years ago for it, it was not. It was very based on materials and courses, and it was not based on the instructional design journey. Now, maybe your experience is different, but I know a lot of people who went through the program that I went through at the University of Texas at Austin. It was not about a learning journey, never even thought about that, or it never came up in my graduate school.
Hmm. Yeah, that's what I was saying. It never came up in mine either. The whole journey, the whole picture, it never came up. It was all based on how do we make better instruction within the classroom environment, right? Mm-hmm. Everything was based on the classroom environment. You know, you've got an hour. How are you going to teach it, right? Or how do you build a collection of 1 hour instruction across a semester, right? Or a year on one particular topic, right? Everything always kind of started around that mental model. And I think over time we've shifted to, well, let's just think about adult learners on the corporate side and make it something totally different. And let's just think about what we need to support them and to make them better at the work that they're doing. And that did kind of shift everything and change the picture a little bit. And we got to thinking about the learning journey and all of that kind of stuff. And then design thinking came into the scene, and it was like, oh, well, we can use that too. That's kind of, you know, where we should all be looking. So it's a big movement that's shifted over the decades for sure.
Right. And it looks like someone recently did have, reasonably recently, oh no, that isn't, that was 2000.
I'll call that recently.
No, that's great that you had that. And I guess Alexander may have too, because that's how he's talking about it. Mine was very computer-based oriented. I was on the computer track, but it was still very material oriented. So you know, I guess everyone's had different experiences, but that's great if your experience was like this, you know, that's wonderful.
I think that's why conversations like this are so important, because I think it's great for everybody to ask these questions and to see that there are a lot of differing opinions and a lot of different reasons why we all have the different opinions that we do. And for all of us to kind of start to come together on this, you know, the differences and how design thinking can be good and how we can think differently and in the end all be more effective at the work we do.
Mm-hmm. Well, Alexander's offering to come in to join us for a session to follow up on this. And we'll take you up on that, Alexander.
Yeah, absolutely.
For sure. Absolutely, yeah. For sure.
Brent, I have open slots in the April calendar if you'd like to
there we go.
Connect.
You know what's kind of interesting? When I was in graduate school, I never even heard of the ADDIE model. It wasn't until I got out into the working world. Yeah. It was very cognitive science oriented, and you know, the Dick and Carey method was the approach. And there's still things from Dick and Carey that I like. There are still some things that remind me of action mapping. I mean, it's a very long, involved, you know, it's probably got 15 steps or something. I can't remember, maybe 10. But there were some things in there that remind me of action mapping. And there were a few things here and there that I really liked, but it was very old school and traditional. Took a long, long time till you got to the end, but we no one ever mentioned ADDIE. So I was surprised to find out about it when I got out into the real world.
Very cool.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a lot of that stuff can kind of be scrapped. I can remember I had a real heavy focus on the Hanifin and Peck media selection guide, because back in the day you got to pick one media. How are you going to teach this? What's the best medium to use for it? Are you going to use video? Are you going to use text? Are you going to use overhead slide projectors? Are you going to use multiple carousels of 35 millimeter slides synced together with a tape recorder? Right?
Wow. That's really amazing. That is old school.
Good times.
When I first came into this world, I was provided with a model which sought to divide evenly between the media types. Five things: 20% text, 20% images, 20% video, 20% animations. And I forget, there was five, and everything was supposed to be almost literally sliced into this equal, you know, ratio. Part of the argument or the perspective, you know, if I recall correctly at the time, was the, you know, part of that was to help people who learn differently. We won't even go down that path here today.
Don't start but, that.
and so this was on the job. This was the model that I had, was presented with when I first started doing this type of work in wow. our space. So,
wow, that really is different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, one thing that I wanted to say that I found works well, if you're, I think one of the reasons design thinking works well for some people and some projects, luckily no one is forcing anyone to use this approach, is that it involves an interdisciplinary team. So when I'm doing workshops, we'll have four or five people sitting together at a table, and they have, they're all coming from different backgrounds, but at work, you're going to have your marketing person, your business person, your finance person, rather, your ID, your stakeholder, maybe an audience member. And so imagine the fire and the what can emerge from that kind of conflict and beautiful conglomeration of different perspectives, you know. And I'm really excited. I wanted to mention that Sharon Baller, and I forget who the other author is, writing a book on design thinking. And when did she say that would be out? In June? In a few months.
Okay.
So awesome. I'm really looking forward to reading that, okay, and just cool. what her approach is, because I'm sure it is a little bit different. But anyway, back to this. So the thing that I found that it's really works well when we get to the ideate phase and we want to brainstorm. So if you are doing this with a group, a lot of people who are introverted do not like to brainstorm in front of people. And there's some research showing that that technique, it does not really work well. So what I've been doing is using solo brainstorming. So everyone has 5 or 10 minutes to just sketch and think and write things out and make mind maps and work quietly alone. And you can hear a pin drop. It's so quiet in the room. And that gives people who maybe, you know, there's some people who like come up with ideas like this, and there are people who are more thoughtful and slower, and they will come up with fantastic ideas too. They need a little time. So we accommodate that. And then the thing that I like, you know, all those stock photos of people putting stickies. Well, you know, I tell people, okay, you're going to be a stock photo now. And I take photos of it. Then people put their ideas on the wall or on a giant piece of paper, but everyone is busy. So no one is really paying attention to what you're writing. So that's another way to brainstorm with sticky notes, and it stops any kind of embarrassment or introversion that someone might feel. And then when everything is up there and people have generated lots of ideas and they're finished generating ideas, then they all get together and cluster the sticky notes into, it's called an affinity map, and I don't like that name because I think of a map as something different, but anyway, or an affinity diagram, and they cluster the ideas into groups. No one knows whose idea is what, and it just really works out well, and you've got these different ideas that can, these different groups that can become a learning journey. So it's really fun. I just want to let anyone know that who wants to try it out.
I like so many things about that. It prevents the group from finding something and or personality driven aspects of the group from sort of focusing on one thing right away and that becoming the thing. It brings so many more things forward as options that could be then, you know, looked at, evaluated, considered. I definitely appreciate the that quiet time aspect too. Lots of folks chiming in the chat too, about their own introversion and how that kind of, this kind of a process might support them in that too. That's really quite neat.
Martha asks, so what about remote team members? And I've been able to, I just bookmarked a tool, and the name's not coming to mind, so do a search for it. And if you can't find it, please email me. I'll put my email address in. And I bookmarked a tool that is for remote, you know, for virtual sticky notes. And that may not be as anonymous. You know, I thought of another example of when you want to be anonymous in your brainstorming, and that is, what if your boss is in the room? Mm. That's the worst environment for brainstorming. Kind of want to, like, you're embarrassed, you know, because when you're brainstorming, you want to come up with crazy ideas, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, having your boss in the room isn't so great.
Yeah. And that, I think at that point that I think a good boss realizes that they have a tendency to cause that kind of anxiety in people, and they will either extract themselves from the environment and say, good luck, everybody, come back and let me know when yes. you're done. Or else they're so comfortable with their crew, they're able to break the ice a little bit maybe and put up some really stupid ideas themselves just to kind of make everybody feel better.
and now we're getting some virtual Padlet. That might have been it. I've heard of Padlet.
There's a few out there, and you know what? There's some really clever ways to do this kind of thing with not specific whiteboarding tools, but just the tools that exist within like Zoom and Connect and all those different like webinar-ish, you know, sharing style tools. They have features where you can kind of do this kind of thing and multiple people can jump in and add stuff to it. You could even probably use like a Google Docs or something, like a Google Slides, and everybody can jump in and add the words in a Google Slide thing or something. I don't know. We can get really creative with this stuff, because this is the beautiful thing about this, right? And the reason why I think design thinking is so important now more than ever is that we have all this tech, all these tools, all these different ways of connecting either virtually and talking together, like you just like a live stream kind of thing like this, and then pulling up whiteboards, sharing screens, you know, everybody being able to work on one doc at the same time. It really just opens the door for us to be way more creative than we've ever been able to.
Yeah. It's pretty exciting. I'm so glad there was one point where I was going to quit the field. And it was when everything was online, but we had no bandwidth and we were dialing in. Mm.
Yep.
This is insane. This is worse than it used to be. We're going backwards. I'm so glad I stayed.
Yeah, I hit the same point. I think I hit that point twice. Once was when we were calling it CBTs, and it just got really boring. Creating computer-based training before the internet was really boring. And then the internet hit, and it was like, ooh, I think I'm going to like this. I think this is going to be cool.
Right. Frames dropping out of your video. It was so frustrating.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You couldn't even, like, everybody's so spoiled today, right? You drag a video onto your, you know, authoring tool or whatever you're using, and boom, it shows up. We had to hand code. I mean, here I am being the old guy, but back in my day, we had to hand code everything to get a video to play on the dang screen with a 486 Pentium processor and blah, blah, blah.
Right. Well, I had to walk to school for 10 miles in the snow.
So. Yeah.
Very cool. All right. Well, let's get off of our porches and stop yelling at those kids to get off our lawns here. Connie, thanks so much for joining us here today. It's been fascinating. And I think we're going to take up Alexander's offer on joining us for an upcoming episode.
Great.
To keep moving this conversation forward. Always very fun to be able to bring forward different ideas, tweak some thinking, and even just seeing how sometimes things actually overlap as opposed to necessarily being a complete revolution or babies in bathwaters, as someone mentioned in the chat earlier as well. Yeah.
Yeah, Connie, hey, let's not leave here too fast without saying, too, we are going to Learning Solutions. So if you guys are going to go, if you're still going, if you still feel like traveling, we're going to be there. And we have a booth. Yay.
Yes. We're doing this Wednesday issue live from the booth. So come and join us for that. We have a very fairly interactive time plan. No individual expertise, but hoping to bring into a nice group conversation. And also we're bringing on the Tuesday, Kevin Thorne is joining us. Kevin's done a couple of what we've called drink and draw episodes here with us, teaching us, for instance, that visual alphabet. And we're going to have a drink and draw during the free drink hour or two. So Kevin's going to join us there to walk us through some drawing lessons with a drink in our hand as well, taking the drink and draw to the next level, as we like to think of it.
And so, Connie, if you're going to be there, yeah, you should come and do a visual thing with us too.
Okay. Kevin is the best.
Mm.
Kevin's just great. I'm so happy you're having him on to do that.
It's so much fun. It's both an amazement because of what he can do, and at the same time, he's trying to empower those of us who trouble beyond the stick drawings to actually move along too. So yeah, it's going to be lots of fun. So very cool. So if folks are joining, going to Learning Solutions, make sure you pop by, especially for the Wednesday morning episode at 10 Eastern, if you're coming from outside of the time zone. So
yep. Anything else you want to pitch, Connie?
Nope.
No, throw some contacts in.
Links in the chat there for folks to reach out to you. And I think I hear something.
Ooh, 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 ooh. That's bad taste, Brent.
That is awful.
God, that's awful. I think that's frightening people away.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Have fun, guys.
Bye. Take care.
See you next time.